institution or other, a kindergarten in a poor neighborhood, perhaps, or a drop-in center for the mentally challenged. Not too many things you could throw around or use for stabbing. Even the cutlery is plastic. The odor is of deep fat frying oil blended with pine-scented disinfectant, with a wash of tepid coffee over all. I purchase a small iced tea in an old-fashioned glazed, which squeaks styrofoam. After I'd consumed half of it, which was all I could get down, I picked my way across the slippery floor to the woman's washroom. In the course of my walks, I've been compiling a map in my head of all the easily accessible washrooms in Port Ticonderoga, so useful if you're caught short, and the one at the donut shop is my current favorite. Not that it's cleaner than the rest, or more likely to have toilet paper, but it offers inscriptions. They all do, but in most locales, these are painted over frequently, whereas in the donut shop, they remain on view much longer. Thus, you have not only the text, but the commentary on it as well. The best sequence at the moment is the one in the middle cubicle. The first sentence is in pencil, in rounded lettering like those on Roman tombs, engraved deeply in the paint. Don't eat anything you aren't prepared to kill. Then, in green marker,
seen of her but the top of her downy head and one tiny hand, finger.
words that distressed her. She was particularly alarmed by the maimed veterans on the street corners, the loungers, the pencil sellers, the panhandlers, too shattered to work at anything. One glaring red-faced man with no legs who pushed himself around on a flat cart would always set her off. Perhaps it was the fury in his eyes. As most small children do, Laura believed words meant what they said, but she carried it to extremes. You couldn't say, "Get lost," or "Go jump in the lake," and expect no consequences. What did you say to Laura? Don't you ever learn? Rainey would scold, but even Rainey herself didn't learn altogether. She once told Laura to bite her tongue because that would keep the questions from coming out, and after that, Laura couldn't chew for days. Now I am coming to my mother's death. It would be trite to say that this event changed everything, but it would also be true. So I will write it down. This event changed everything. It happened on a Tuesday, a bread day. All of our bread, enough in a batch for an entire week, was made in the kitchen at a Avilion. Although there was a small bakery in Port Ticonderoga by then, Rainey said store bread was for the lazy, and the baker added chalk to it to stretch out the flour, and also extra yeast to swell the loaves up with an air so you'd think you were getting more. And so she made the bread herself. The kitchen of Avilion wasn't dark like the sooty Victorian cavern it must once have been 30 years before. Instead, it was white. White walls, white enameled table, white wood burning range, black and white tiled floor, with daffodil yellow curtains at the new enlarged windows. It had been redone after the war as one of my father's sheepish, gifts to my mother. Rainey considered this kitchen the latest thing, and as a result of my mother's having taught her about germs and their nasty ways and their hiding places, she kept it faultlessly clean. On bread days, Rainey would give us scraps of dough for bread men with raisins for the eyes and buttons. Then she would bake them for us. I would eat mine, but Laura would save her some. Once Rainey found a whole row of them in Laura's top drawer, hard as a rock, wrapped up in her handkerchiefs like tiny bun-faced mummies. Rainey said they would attract mice and would have to go straight into the garbage, but Laura held out for a mass burial in the kitchen garden behind the rhubarb bush. She said there had to be prayers. If not, she would never eat her dinner anymore. She was always a hard bargainer once she got down to it. Rainey dug the hole. It was a gardener's day off. She used his spade, which was off limits to anyone else, but this was an emergency. God pity her, husband said Rainey, as Laura laid her breadmen out in a neat row. She's stubborn as a pig. I'm not going to have a husband anyway, said Laura. I'm going to live by myself in the garage. I'm not going to have one either, I said, not to be outdone. Fat chance of that, said Rainey. You like your nice soft bed. You'd have to sleep on the cement and get all covered in grease and oil. I'm going to live in the conservatory, I said. It's not heated anymore, said Rainey. You'll freeze to death in the winters. I'll sleep in one of the motor cars, said Laura. On that horrible Tuesday, we'd had breakfast in the kitchen with Rainey. It was oatmeal porridge and toast with marmalade. Sometimes we had it with Mother, but that day she was too tired. Mother was stricter and made us sit up straight and eat the crusts. Remember the starving Armenians, she would say. Perhaps the Armenians were no longer starving by then. The war was long over. Order had been restored. But their plight must have remained in Mother's mind as a kind of slogan. A slogan, an invocation, a prayer, a charm. Toast crusts must be eaten in memory of these Armenians, whoever they may have been. Not to eat them was sacrilege. Laura and I must have understood the weight of this charm, because it never failed to work. Mother didn't eat her crusts that day. I remember that. Laura went on at her about it. What about the crusts? What about the starving Armenians? Until finally Mother admitted that she didn't feel well. When she said